Now, for our main event this evening, it is my true pleasure to welcome Dr. Lisa Tetrault, who is an associate professor of history at Carnegie Mellon University. She specializes in the history of gender, race, and American democracy, with an emphasis on memory and social movements. She is the author of the prize-winning book, The Myth of Seneca Falls, Memory and the Women's Suffrage Movement, 1848 to 1898. A frequent commentator on the suffrage centennial, Tetrault also serves as a historical consultant for the 19th Amendment projects launched by the National Constitution Center, the Woodrow Wilson House, the Schlesinger Library, and Ancestry.com, as well as, and I highly suggest this as well, the documentary, The Vote. It's located at PBS's American Experience. Again, another wonderful resource for learning in this point in time. She's the recipient of the fellowships from the National Endowment for the Humanities, Harvard's Radcliffe Institute, the Smithsonian Institution, and the Library of Congress, and is currently at work on a genealogy of the 19th Amendment. Without further ado, please welcome with me Dr. Tetrault to our Zoom stage.
Hi, everyone. So good to be with you. I'm going to just take a second here and do the awkward Zoom sharing of my slides. Shout out to the person in Coralville. That is my native land. So here we go. And did not share my screen, did it? Which screen did it share?
It is sharing your screen, and all you need
I don't have a green box around it, so I couldn't tell. Okay.
Get that into presentation mode, and we'll.
Does everyone see the full screen?
Spectacular.
Okay, great. So I'm delighted to be with you. This lecture will probably be a bit of a deviation from what you might have expected, but I hope that what you'll find is that the stories that we tell about the past have a lot of resonance with our future and with our present. And I became a historian partly because I believe that the stories we tell about the past are really stories we tell about ourselves today. And I wanna tell a story about 1920 that'll hopefully inform your sense of your own citizenship and your own sense of as a voter, if you are a voter. So I thought I'd start with this map, which is of course the reason we're all together, that date, 1920, emblazoned across the United States, which was the date that the 19th Amendment was added to the Constitution. Headlines like these celebrated things that we still celebrate today. Tennessee House ratifies federal amendment, giving women of the entire nation vote this fall. So keep track of women of the entire nation. Or if you do any basic Google search, you'll be assured of the same, which is that Congress passed the amendment. It was then ratified, and it granted women the right to vote. Or down below, as it says, this is from rdocs.gov, it guarantees all women the right to vote. And these are the things we hear over and over again about the 19th Amendment. But if you look at this map again, you will see that there is, right after this 1920, an asterisk right here on this date. And that asterisk actually contains multitudes and contains universes that I think many of us are unaware of around the stories of 1920. So instead of doing a sort of traditional biographical compendium story today, I'm going to focus instead on that asterisk. And by focusing on that asterisk, I'm going to shift us from the usual suspects of the campaign and their tales of heroism, although we'll have plenty of that, and talk instead about the Constitution. Because we are, in fact, amending a constitution here. And one of the things that I think it's helpful to do during the centennial is go back to our constitution and ask ourselves exactly what in the constitution are we amending and how are we amending it? So the first thing I'm going to say today will probably come as a surprise to you, the first major point that I have here. And that is that in the constitution, there is no right to vote for citizens. I think almost any American you would ask would say that the Constitution gives them the right to vote, or that the most sacred right of citizenship is in fact voting. And in fact, that is an American myth. We have no right to vote. We are one of the only constitutional democracies in the world that does not include a right to vote for its citizens in its charter. And the reasons for this are varied, partly because the founding framers did not themselves think they were setting up a democracy. They thought they were setting up a republic. And they were deeply conflicted, deeply divided, and deeply suspect about voters, about who should vote, about who should be able to vote. And you can see this all over the founding framers' letters and notes to one another about, you know, just how is this new idea of voters going to work? Who gets in on this and who doesn't? And basically what they decide is that we're not going to create a right to vote. What we'll do instead is kick this question over to the states. Because remember, we set up this system of federalism whereby states govern some things and federal government governs others. And they give to the states the right to create voters. So in other words, they don't kick to the states voting rights because there are no voting rights. And that is still true today. What they kick to the states is the idea of you get to decide who the voters are. And that is still true today, although we'll talk about how that's changed and how the story of federalism has evolved around this question. But you get to decide who the voters are. And so what the states do is create a list of the different voter eligibility requirements that you have to meet. And those include, obviously, some of the same things we have today. Citizenship, there were residency requirements. Almost all states said that you had to be male, and almost all states said that you had to be white. But not all states said you had to be male or white. In fact, in New Jersey, there was no white or male clause in New Jersey's 1776 constitution where they appointed voters. So if you met those other requirements, residency and property and citizenship, you could vote. And we know that some women voted in New Jersey, and we believe some women of color voted in New Jersey prior to 1807 when New Jersey stuck male into its constitution. So the point that I'm trying to make here is that there are long lists that the states draw up of who you have to be a voter. And that has evolved over time and continues to evolve right now. And those list of qualifications generally are allowed because there is no right to vote that they're abridging. If there was a federal right to vote, then you wouldn't be able to list those qualifications because it would be abridging a fundamental right a citizen held. So I'm going to jump forward now from the founding and sort of go on this epic odyssey of how voting expands and contracts in America. Because I think the story we usually tell is one of steady opening, whereby more and more people get led in to the right to vote in the Constitution. And that's not quite what happens. By the 1820s and the 1830s, every state has put in the words, among a bunch of other words, about who you had to be a voter. White and male. And this is what bars women from voting, that word in state constitutions that say voters have to be male. Over the 30s and the 40s, if we flash forward, there's a women's rights movement that grows out of anti-slavery. A bunch of women get involved in the anti-slavery movement, black and white, as you can see here in this very rare photograph from the pre-Civil War era. This is an outdoor anti-slavery meeting. And as you can see, it's co-ed, it's biracial. This was highly unusual in the 1830s and 40s. And women were attacked for being out in public, speaking forcefully, speaking their minds. They were supposed to be home and in the domestic sphere and be passive. And so women then start to defend themselves and say, I have a right to be in public. I have a right to speak my mind. And out of that grows a women's rights movement of sorts. There are many women's rights movements in the 19th century. This is just one that we're talking about, the more conventional one. And then eventually there will be some women's rights conventions, one that I've written a great deal about, the story of Seneca Falls in 1848, which would be the first women's rights convention. And really by the 1850s, and you see here Elizabeth Cady Stanton, who will visit again. Some of you may be wondering why Susan B. Anthony's not on this slide. We can talk about that in the Q&A if you want. She wasn't there. Then by the 1850s, we really get a sort of visible mainstream women's rights movement. And like I say, there are other rights movements going on at the same time. And this was also a biracial movement and also co-ed. Plenty of men were involved in that. And among the demands that are made both here at Seneca Falls and after, are a whole series of things. And among those is voting rights. So they would demand things like, many of which surprisingly have still not been won, equal pay for women, full access to the professions, the ability to preach in church, reform of dress, property holding, the end of the sexual double standard. And famously at Seneca Falls, they would also demand the right to vote, although it was not the first demand for the right to vote. That's part of the mythology that I discuss in my first book. But the person who stands up to defend it is Frederick Douglass. And Frederick Douglass is at this point an emerging African-American statesman, an escaped slave, and an emerging abolitionist. He defends it, and with that, it goes forward into the Declaration of Sentiments, which is the kind of manifesto that comes out of the Seneca Falls Convention, the Women's Rights Manifesto. And it's famously modeled on the Declaration of Independence, saying, "We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men and women are created equal." And then instead of listing grievances against the king, it lists a bunch of grievances against man and then a bunch of demands. So the thing I want to point out about the voting at this era is, A, it's one piece of a much larger vision. No one in the antebellum period, this period before the American Civil War, would say that they're part of a women's suffrage movement. That's a creation we talk about later. They're part of a women's rights movement, which includes a voting demand, but it is not the focus of the, and many people don't even think it's the most important issue. And the other thing is, this women's rights movement is not demanding a constitutional amendment for voting, because everyone understands in the antebellum period, the Constitution has nothing to do with voting. So you wouldn't demand a constitutional amendment to create women's suffrage, right? That would be nonsensical. It wouldn't make any sense at all. So what they were trying to do was strike that word male in the individual states. So where does the constitutional amendment come from, and how do we get the feds involved in this story? Well, that's a fascinating tale, and we'll shift there. That happens after the American Civil War. So the American Civil War settles two things. One, we will remain a union. We will remain an undivided nation. And two, chattel slavery will be ended. What that means, though, opens an entirely new fight. Although arms are laid down, at least army arms, there is a new fight, and that is, what is the status of freed people? Are they citizens? Are they covered by the same laws as white Americans? Will they have the right to vote? Will they have reparations? Will they get land? And will they be repaid for their years of bondage? And that opens an entirely new fight in the United States that we can't get into today. But out of that fight comes a variety of different decisions, including the very first debate in the US Congress about the voting rights of citizens. Because the Congress wants to enfranchise Black men. And Black men themselves and African Americans are demanding enfranchisement as a necessary piece of their new citizenship. And Congress then passes in 1869 the very first constitutional amendment around voting, around citizens voting, and that is the 15th Amendment, the 1869, they pass it in 69, ratified in 70. And it says, what I want to point out is there's a lot of different proposals for what the 15th Amendment should say. And it's having its 150th anniversary, and it's very much part of the story of the 19th. And one of the things people think is, let's argue that citizens have a right to vote. Let's say the 15th Amendment is going to say citizens have a right to vote. But Congress has no appetite for that because citizen states really like discriminating in voting. And if we did that amendment, it would force all the states to end all of their discriminatory practices, or what we would call discriminatory practices. And so Congress has no appetite for that. But what they will say to the South, where most African Americans still lived, over 90%, you may not discriminate in voting on the basis of race, color, or previous condition of servitude. So it does not grant a right to vote, but what it does is strike down the obstacle of race, that word white, if we go back to those two words that are in constitutions, and thereby gives Black men access to voting. And Black men start voting in massive numbers after the American Civil War. And we have really a robust experiment in biracial democracy in the South after the American Civil War. And we'll come back to that story in a minute. When this is passed by Congress and goes to the states for ratification, coming back to our women's rights movement and our abolitionist movement, they regroup after the American Civil War. And they formed something called the American Equal Rights Association. Slavery's been ended, and they say, okay, what do we fight for now? And they decide what they'll fight for is the right to vote for African Americans and for women. So in their organization, when the 15th Amendment comes up, they say, wow, you know, here's half of what we wanted. How do we go about making sure this gets ratified and added to the US Constitution? Except for a few dissenters. And the dissenters are Elizabeth Cady Stanton and Susan B. Anthony, who you see here. Elizabeth Cady Stanton was, these two are probably the most famous feminist friendship in the 19th century. They were best friends. You can't understand their careers without one another. Stanton was one of the organizers of the Seneca Falls Convention in 1848, which really launched her reform career. Susan B. Anthony lived a few hours up the road in Rochester, and she will meet Stanton in 1851. And from that point forward, they will be the best of friends and the fiercest of co-agitators. And they dissent around the 15th Amendment in this coalition. And they say no. And famously, Elizabeth Cady Stanton gets into a very vicious fight at this meeting with Frederick Douglass, who had, remember, stood up to defend women's voting in Seneca Falls. Stanton says to Douglass some quite racist things, that she will not have ignorant Black Sambos voting before educated white womanhood, showing a pretty strong sense of racial hierarchy. And Frederick Douglass shouts back that, you know, their lives are at stake. They're being hung from lampposts in the South, African-Americans, and they're having their brains dashed out on the pavement. And the vote is a matter of life and death, and the 15th Amendment must be ratified. And Stanton and Anthony disagree. They refuse to support the 15th Amendment. They think it's an indignity to white womanhood. And they bolt and they form the nation's first National Woman Suffrage Association. And this is really when a suffrage movement is born, when women are dedicated to this one goal as opposed to a broader slate of goals as the kind of pinnacle of their reform agenda. And they form the national, and their allies are appalled. Their allies are like, this is inconceivable. This is a really important piece of a democratic project. We must support this. And many of those very famous allies are people we don't know about today, which is something I discuss in my book. But one of them is a woman named Lucy Stone, who had been lecturing as an anti-slavery advocate and a women's rights advocate since 1847. She was just as famous as Stanton and Anthony, just as a luminist. And she and a variety of other people go on and form the American Woman Suffrage Association. And they say, you know, no, we must support the 15th Amendment and then continue to press for women's enfranchisement. And at this meeting, I'll point out, there are still lots and lots of African-American women, including Frances Ellen Watkins Harper, one of the most prominent sort of female civil rights activists in this era and women's rights activists. And she will say to the assembly sort of earlier, but again, making this kind of intersectional critique that we like to credit ourselves with in the modern era. We are all bound up together, she says, in one great bundle of humanity. And while, you know, we must not divide this question, because she understands that she straddles both of these categories, right? And those women will generally start to leave mainstream white suffrage organizing because it doesn't suit their needs, and they will organize with Black men. But they will dip in and out of white organizing as they need to and as they want white women's assistance. What Stan and Anthony decide, if we go back to this division in 1869, so a woman's suffrage movement is born but divided with two national movements. Stan and Anthony decide, okay, we hate the 15th Amendment, but the only redeeming thing about the 15th Amendment is that it federalizes voting for the first time in US history, right? It puts the feds in charge of voting. And so therefore, what we think what we ought to do is now follow the 15th Amendment with a 16th Amendment, which should say, it copies the text of the 15th Amendment, that the right of citizens to vote shall not be denied or abridged on account of sex, right? Which would strike that word male from state constitutions. This also does not grant a voting right, much like the 15th Amendment. It's a negative affirmation. Meanwhile, Lucy Stone and the other folks say, absolutely not. Voting is a state prerogative. The 15th Amendment was merely a war measure. And if we want to win women's suffrage, we have to work at the state level, striking the word male state by state by state, because that is the way constitution the Constitution sets up voting governance in the United States. So there are real differences between these two organizations. This amendment will go nowhere, right, for roughly 50 years. It'll finally be ratified in 1920, but this is the text of the 19th Amendment. And it will go nowhere. It'll become the 19th because other amendments will get passed and ratified, in the interim. But that state story, if we go back to the states and take our eyes off the federal story for a minute, states start enfranchising women, or at least they start striking the word male and thereby incidentally enfranchise women. Wyoming is the first, Wyoming Territory. Wyoming doesn't put the word male in their voter qualifications in 1869. Utah, 1870. And then by the 1890s and the 1910s, all of the Western states have struck the word male voluntarily from their voter qualifications through suffrage activism, right, which is taking place at the ground level. And that's really where the campaign picks up tremendous momentum. And part of why we get a federal amendment, because so many women are already voting, and they're showing, they're A, pressing for making this a federal issue, and B, showing that if women vote, the family is not gonna collapse, civilization is not gonna collapse, and the world will not be thrown off its axis, which is much of the anti-suffrage argument. So this is a map I wanna show you on the eve of ratification. So this is 1919. On the eve of Congress passing the 19th Amendment. And this is where women's voting stood, or at least where the question of sex stood. In all these salmon-colored states, women voted on the same terms as men, okay? That just means there was no male barring them. They voted on the same terms that men did. In the denim-colored states over here, these all didn't allow women to vote on any terms whatsoever. And then there's all these kind of multicolored states. And those had what was called partial suffrage, which is something we forget about. Partial suffrage said that women can vote in certain kinds of elections. So sex is not a bar to, say, these light blue states voting in presidential elections, but sex is a bar for all other kinds of elections. And so women were voting in some types of elections in all these other states. There were only 8 states where women were not voting on some basis or another when the 19th Amendment passed Congress. And the 19th Amendment we'll get to in a minute. But what I want to point out too is that some of these women voting in this early era were women of color. We argue women of color didn't get the right to vote in this era, but there's no universal statement. It depends where you live. So the great anti-lynching activist, civil rights activist, journalist, Ida B. Wells, she lived in Chicago. And when Chicago, if you look here, passes a municipal suffrage, which is this kind of gray color, she organizes Black women to vote, and they managed to vote in the first Black city alderperson Chicago had ever had. So I want to point out, women and women of color are doing important voting initiatives and using electoral power before 1920. Okay, so let's go back to that division between the national and the American. That division is healed in 1890, and those two organizations come together into this very creatively named, they put National American together, they call it the National American Woman Suffrage Association, or NAWSAW. People usually pronounce this acronym. And Carrie Chapman Catt will take over leadership of this from Stanton and Anthony. Stanton will die in 1902, Anthony will die in 1906, and Lucy Stone dies in 1893, so she was never much a part of the National American Woman Suffrage Association. But Catt has decided by this point, by the 1900s, that a federal amendment is unwinnable, and that the goal is to keep the momentum alive in the states. And so she thinks if we can get enough states to fall, that it'll have a domino effect and eventually bring about a federal amendment. Meanwhile, because social movements are incredibly divisive and incredibly messy, we'd like to remember this in this kind of harmonious way, but they're not that harmonious. Alice Paul, this young upstart, is part of NAWSAW. And she had been living overseas in England, where she learned about British militants and joined British militants. She'll come back to the United States and start arguing that rather than doing this kind of currying the favor of politicians and trying to get their a buy-in, that we should just bring the fight right to their face and make them uncomfortable. So from inside NAWSAW, she's going to start trying to revive the federal amendment campaign. She's also fed up with this state by state thing. And she will start launching these kind of theatrical tactics that we often associate with ratification. While Carrie Chapman Catt is, you know, plotting a very careful ground game in the States. She will famously launch the 1913 suffrage parade in Washington, D.C. She'll launch this parade on the eve of Woodrow Wilson's inauguration to basically stick it to him, to basically take away his thunder and steal his, you know, moment of glory, because he doesn't support a woman suffrage amendment. So this is specifically meant to, you know, poke a finger at Woodrow Wilson. And you can see here the amendment is written on this float. They're introducing the nation to this amendment. And women dress in white. Turns out tens of thousands of people show up to watch this parade. If you see close-up shots, they're amazing, because what you see is a sea of male hats. And you realize this is a largely male audience, an almost exclusively male audience, and women marching in the streets. And this was one of the first massive peaceful protests in Washington, D.C., one of the first times citizens had kind of taken over the streets of Washington, D.C. It gets ugly. The crowd starts to riot, and the crowd starts to rush into the streets and attack the women. The police look the other way. And their argument is, if you're going to, you know, sort of abdicate the protection that the home offers you and go into the streets, then we have no reason to protect you. So the other thing that happens in this parade, and what we see, is that long simmering racial tension in the movement. Ida B. Wells, that great anti-lynching activist, shows up with the Illinois delegation to march in the parade. And Alice Paul asks her to march in the rear of the parade. There are other civil rights activists, Mary Church Terrell. There's a Black sorority chapter that shows up to march in the parade, and they are all asked to march in the rear of the parade. Ida B. Wells will famously refuse, and she will slip in with the Illinois delegation and march in a kind of integrated parade. Eventually, Alice Paul realizes that she gets front page headlines with this melee that ends up breaking out. She upstages Woodrow Wilson, and she realizes that press, any press, is good press, in the old saying. She will then get kicked out of the National Woman's Party, of NASA. Carrie Chapman Catt can't stand her. She thinks she's courting trouble. She's gonna lose the favor of politicians. She forms the National Woman's Party, goes straight for a federal amendment, and goes straight for this kind of theatrical social protest. Famously, one of the things they do in 1917 is start picketing the White House. No one had ever really done this before. And they just stand there. They were called the Silent Sentinels. They hold the flag of the National Woman's Party, which is this color of, you've probably seen these three colors. It's the colors of the National Woman's Party. They hold the flags, and they have flags in these signs that they have here say things like, "Mr. President, how long must women wait for liberty?" Woodrow Wilson is really annoyed, but he can't get these women off because they're standing on public property, right? In the People's House, they're standing in front of the People's House. Then World War I breaks out. Here we are at the World War I Museum. And you don't picket a wartime president. That is not patriotic. But these women, after a debate, decide to go right on picketing the president. Partly because Woodrow Wilson is entering World War I to keep the world safe for democracy, right? And they think this is a prime opportunity to point out how Woodrow Wilson is absolutely denying democracy at home. So they use the international stage to embarrass America, and that too will help push the amendment over to victory. Meanwhile, Carrie Chapman Catt and her group are appalled that Alice Paul is picketing a wartime president. They throw their support behind the war, and they say, if we can show that we're good citizens that support the war, then they'll give us the amendment. That too ends up being part of why the amendment passes. But by this point, Woodrow Wilson has had enough. Oh, and I should also point out, one of the banners they unfurl says Kaiser Wilson. On it, which is, of course, we're fighting the Kaiser in World War I, and they start calling him the Kaiser. And they start reading his words about saving democracy and kind of throwing them into a trash barrel. Eventually, Woodrow Wilson's had enough. He wants these women arrested. But the thing is, they're not breaking any laws. So he has them arrested on the grounds of obstructing traffic. They are sentenced. They refuse to pay this fine. They are essentially political prisoners. Which we're not supposed to have in the United States. They go to jail because they refuse to pay the fine and endure horrific and horrible conditions. And one of the things I'll point out here is that women of color and plenty of other women have endured these horrible conditions and violence for a long time. But it's shocking to see sort of upstanding white women who are supposed to be immune from this kind of violence, enduring it at the hands of the state. Then these women launch a hunger protest, a hunger strike. And the prison warden, and probably up to the president, doesn't want to have a martyr on their hands if someone dies. So they start force feeding these women. They stick tubes down their throat or up their noses, down their esophagus, into their stomachs, and they pour kind of mixed, liquid ingredients down them. Alice Paul would have stomach trouble for the rest of her life, as would many others. They are eventually released from jail. They become a cause célèbre. For a whole variety of reasons, this finally makes its way up to Congress to be voted on. Congress had voted it down the year earlier, and Alice Paul had sent out a whole bunch of people to get those. They sent out the prison special. They had women dressed in prison garbs on trains, advocating for the voting out of the people who would oppose the 19th Amendment and the voting in of people who would do so. It finally passes in 1919, passes both houses of Congress by the extraordinary majority a constitutional amendment requires. And I want to point out that, remember all those Western states where women are voting? They have elected a female to Congress. And there's one woman who gets to vote for the constitutional amendment, the 19th Amendment, and that is Jeanette Rankin, a Republican out of Montana, who's part of Congress. She goes to Congress in 1917. She will also incidentally be the only person to ever vote against both world wars. She voted against World War I and World War II. So it clears Congress with one woman voting for it. And then it goes to the states for ratification, quickly clears a ton of states, and then stops for months, and they're one state short. And it seems quite clear that nobody's gonna take it up until Tennessee decides to take it up. And when Tennessee takes it up, everyone's quite alarmed, because this is a Southern state known for its opposition to women's voting and known for federal interference in voting. Until this young man, all the activists for the vote, all the opponents of the vote pour into Tennessee, into the state capitol. It's a melee again. The liquor lobby is there getting everyone drunk. There are backdoor deals being made for no votes. The suffragists are running through, kind of breaking convention by being out, late at night with a bunch of drunken men. And it comes down to the vote, and it looks like it's going to fail. It's at a tie, and it looks like it's going to be tabled. But then this young man, the youngest member of the Tennessee legislature, and remember at this point, there have been hundreds of votes that have had to happen to get to this point. Gets this letter here from his mother, Feb Burn, and in it she tells him to vote for ratification. She says, "I haven't been able to find your position. What is it? Please vote for it and be a good boy." Literally, she tells him to be a good boy. And with that, Harry Byrne decides, with his, pocket in his breast, the letter in his breast pocket, to vote for it. And with that, it clears by one vote. So ratification is pushed over by a single vote. Another person then changes their vote and it clears by two, but without Harry T. Burns' vote, this wouldn't have cleared. Hallelujah, right? 50 years of fighting for an amendment is finally over. And then we get these headlines that we visited before. Gives women the entire nation vote this fall. We hear these kinds of things in the centennial right now. Guarantees all women of the right to vote. If you go on the web, you will find repeated phrases about this. And what I wanna suggest is that's not true. And we do ourselves a disservice when we think that. And I want to go back to the text of the 19th Amendment. What had passed? The right of citizens to vote shall not be denied or abridged by the United States or by any state on account of sex. That's what the 19th Amendment says. So what women have won is the ending of the word male where it still existed. They have not won a federally affirmative right to vote. They have not been led into a constitutional right to vote, which doesn't exist. What they have done is leveraged federal power, much like the 15th Amendment did, to regulate the states on a certain targeted specific restriction, okay? And that is the way voting rights have proceeded ever since. People leverage the federal government to stop the states from doing targeted specific things. And not all women then could vote after the 19th Amendment. The 19th Amendment was a massive, essential, magnificent victory in all kinds of ways, and would help all women by striking the word male, but would not be sufficient to help all women get actual access to the voting booth. Because, remember, millions of women were already voting before the 19th Amendment. the 19th Amendment brings in another, you know, massive numbers of women, and massive numbers of women, millions, are still not voting. And if we go back to that kind of triumphal story that we often tell of American democracy, of one of just steady opening, which the woman suffrage story seems to be, I want to point out that exactly the same time that these Western states are enfranchising, are taking away the word male anyway, and enfranchising women indirectly, another story is going on simultaneously across the United States, and that is a closing to voter access. Those Black men who had been voting since the 15th Amendment, although under great vigilante violence and voter suppression, by the 1890s, the same time mail is being struck in the states, those Southern states and many other states start to realize the feds don't care anymore if Black men's voting is enforced. So they start passing over the 1890s to the 1910s, Jim Crow voting laws, which are literacy tests, poll taxes, effectively legally now disenfranchising Black men's voting. At the same time that women are great, you know, white women anyway are gradually gaining voting. So those restrictions, which were just put on the books just prior to the 19th Amendment, are still standing and will ensnare many women of color. They will not be able to access the voting booth because although gender does not discriminate them, a poll tax or a voting, you know, or a literacy test or something else will bar them. And these were often fraudulently administered. There's a story of a woman in Virginia, an African-American woman, who in 1920 goes straight down to her local polling place in Phoebus, Virginia, and goes to take the literacy test because she knows she can pass it. And the registrar hands her a blank sheet of paper. So of course she can't pass it because being fraudulently administered. So white registrars have tremendous power to bar people at the registration site. So Black women go to, Black women and Indigenous women and Asian American women, many of whom are all ensnared, Latina women who are ensnared in these laws, which are not just Southern, but also are passed in New York and New Mexico and California. Go to these flagship white suffrage organizations and say, our fight is not over, we must continue. And those white organizations say, we're done here, our fight is over. And that is another real racial tension in the movement. And so what we have to remember too is the fight for women's access to voting does not end in 1920, it just takes a new form. And that is Black women and Indigenous women and Asian American women and Latina women and Pacific Islanders organizing on their own and often in conjunction with men who are also trying to get their voting restored. And these are just some of the women who are quite famously part of the continuing fight for women's access to voting. Although at this point, we would really call it voting rights activism. Although again, we use that term really loosely in American history. And these women's activism and plenty of others and the activism of men will lead finally in 1965 to the signing of the Voting Rights Act. And the Voting Rights Act, even though it's called the Voting Rights Act, does not either create a right to vote. What it does in 1965, and you can see women here in the picture, right? They were part of that story. What it does is it says to the states with those restrictions put in place in the 1890s, those Jim Crow restrictions, you may not do that anymore. Those are racially discriminatory. You can't have literacy tests. You can't bar people from registering. So they send in registrars, they deputize Black Americans to register Black voters. And Black voting participation across the South goes from sort of single digits to, 65 to 85%, you know, in just a very, very short time. But again, a white right to vote has not been won with this. What's happened is the power of the federal government has once again been leveraged by social movements to stop the states from doing targeted specific practices that were keeping people from the ballot box. And with this, really this is when really we have for the first time, a representative American democracy after 1965. It is one of the most significant pieces of federal legislation ever passed. But what I want to point out is it's not only African-American women who are part of this story. There are plenty of other women not voting because they can't get access to citizenship. So Asian-Americans, we had racially targeted citizenship laws, and those kept many women from citizenship. So we passed a Chinese Exclusion Act, barring Asian-Americans from citizenship. There were many Hispanic Americans who could not get citizenship, many indigenous folks who did not get citizenship. And many indigenous folks didn't want citizenship because this was colonization. They were part of other nations. So I want to point out that there is no one date when, you know, some group of women get voting rights. It so depends on what your own what your own demographic makeup is, what set of laws you get ensnared in, and what state you live in. But citizenship laws in the 1950s would change and kind of give women access to citizenship, but then they were ensnared in all those state laws that often kept them from voting. And the Voting Rights Act is going to help all of these women gain access to voting, not just Black women. And then famously in 1982, the reauthorization of the Voting Rights Act was critical because one of the things it said to the states was, I should also say the Voting Rights Act set up federal oversight of states that had histories of discriminating on the basis of race. And anytime that state wanted to pass a law that said, you know, was restricting voting, it had to clear it with the federal government and prove that it wasn't discriminatory before it was passed. And in 1982, Voting Rights Act was reauthorized and started to claim things like we had to have biracial ballots, which was hugely important for lots of people getting voting access. You know, you might be eligible to vote, but if you can't read the ballot, then you're not practically able to vote. The Voting Rights Act, like I say, has really created a robust American democracy in all kinds of ways with federal oversight until 2013. It has been a political project of many people to try to strike down the Voting Rights Act. In 2013, in Shelby County v. Holder, the Supreme Court struck down the Voting Rights Act, or at least important provisions of it. And one of the things they struck down was the idea that the federal government should have oversight of the states. And the majority decision argued that this state voter discrimination or voter disenfranchisement is a thing of the past. We don't do that kind of discrimination anymore, so the Fed should not have a right to intervene in what's a state right. Although I might point out that the Department of Justice, the federal government, brought thousands of examples of racially discriminatory laws that states were trying to pass that the DOJ invalidated. So this question of whether or not discrimination was or was not happening was an open one. The Voting Rights Act is about to expire, the pieces of it that are left, but it is largely gutted. And right now, what's happening is that the states, because they can, and this is a map now, every state would now be red. This is a map, I can't find one that's, have now been putting in place new voter eligibility requirements. Okay, that's the kind of positive language around it. The negative language would be new disenfranchisement techniques, right? And these are often being done in the name of voter fraud, but there is no evidence of voter fraud. Voter fraud seems to be less than 1%. It does exist in some cases, usually by people who don't know they're doing it. It's less than 1%, but currently we're in a situation whereby the states, because there is no right to vote, I mean, because federal oversight kind of stopping them from engaging in discriminatory practices has ended, are now putting in place all kinds of new laws that sound plausible, much like the old laws, shouldn't you be able to read to vote, but are in fact disenfranchising many people who were voting without incident prior by the tens of millions. It's estimated that just between 2016 and 2018, 16 to 18 million people were thrown off the voter rolls. So we are currently in 2020 in the midst of a massive campaign of, should we say, new voter eligibility requirements that the states are erecting, or should we say voter suppression? Should we say voter disenfranchisement? This, of course, depends on what we want to call this as a national community. But it is unmistakable that it's happening. It is not a partisan statement. It is factually happening. And many of these were people who voted without incident prior to this and are now being thrown off the voter rolls. So we're throwing off tens of millions of people ostensibly to address something that is less than a fraction of a percent voter fraud. And I just want to give some examples here of what's happening now. And this is really rampant right now on indigenous, on native reservations, on tribal lands. Naomi White is an attorney. She had lived in Utah. And she moved to the Navajo reservation in Arizona. She knew that on election day, she had voted in Utah without incident. On the Navajo reservation, everyone by the federal government is assigned a post office box. The federal government does not deliver mail to people's homes. You get a post office box. When you register to vote, you are required to put down your mailing address. And your mailing address is, per force, a post office box. Naomi White knew she was going to be out of town on election day and called the county registrar in order to get an absentee ballot. She was told that they had no voting registry for her. She was not registered to vote. And when she inquired why, she found that they had thrown her off because she had an obscure address. So she'd been purged from the voter rolls, supposedly for having fraudulently registered to vote, for having a post office box. They determined that this was an obscure address. Now, she was required to put that down, but then they were saying a P.O. box is not sufficient. She soon found out that 500 some other people on the Navajo reservation had been thrown off the voter rolls. And this is currently happening in reservations all around the country. And a court just decided in North Dakota that it's perfectly fine to require that people put down post office boxes because you have to put your mailing address, and perfectly fine then to disenfranchise them because a post office box is an obscure address. So this is what's happening right now. Another example, Doreen Vargas, she lived in Dodge City, Kansas. In Dodge City, Kansas, what the state started doing, or the city started doing, was shutting down polling locations. Normally in Kansas, a polling location serves 1,300 people, 1,300. In Dodge City, Kansas, they had one polling location and it served 13,000 people because they'd slowly closed polling locations. This was a largely Latina town, meatpacking, overwhelming Hispanic population. Usually voting was at the city arena downtown. That's where it had always been. That's where the city sent out information saying that's where voting would be. Then without notifying anyone, they moved voting to a hangar a mile outside of town. Doreen Vargas stood outside the meatpacking plants passing out information telling people where to go to vote because it had been changed and nobody knew. To her mind, this was voter suppression to keep the Latina vote from being able to actually access the polls. So now, although we are in the centennial of women winning the right to vote, what I want to point out is tens of millions of women are currently having their vote suppressed by all kinds of new mechanisms, women who could previously vote. The Economist has a democracy index, which gauges the health of democracies around the world. We are now downgraded from a full to a flawed democracy because of the disenfranchisement practices going on. And I want to point out, if we had a federal right to vote, all these state tactics would be illegal because they would be infringing upon a right to vote, which we still have not won. That has not been won. And this is a nonpartisan thing. So we are currently, we currently don't make it into the top 25 functioning democracies in the world. So what I want to point out is that this asterisk to this 1920 story helps us understand who we are now, and is actually really essential to understanding what actually happened in 1920, which was monumental and historic and significant, but not sufficient to accomplish the kinds of things we credit it with. So I'll close there.
Dr. Tetrault, thank you so much. And I'm going to echo some of the things that I am seeing both on Zoom and on Facebook live of just you are already getting claps and bravos and thank yous. Thank you for that.
Before I stop sharing my slides, which I'll do just so that we can see me more, I just want to recommend both of these books, which are about the question of kind of how voting has evolved in the United States since the Voting Rights Act was passed in 65. This was a finalist for the National Book Award, and both are really important books. If you're interested in learning more about the fight to end the Voting Rights Act, and also the current state practices that are, people would argue, suppressing the vote right now, or some people would argue stopping voter fraud. So I'll stop sharing my screen. I just wanted to mention both these books. Okay, great.
Thank you. Now is the time, ladies and yes, everyone in the audience, to be sharing your questions. And if you are on our Zoom audience, I'm going to be, as well as Camille Kulig, our public program specialist, will be looking at that Q&A button down there at the bottom. If you're joining us on Facebook Live, we will be taking a look at that chat section, and we will try to get in as many questions as we can in this time frame. Looking back a bit, looking back 100 years ago, and also I think there are echoes which are very present today. How did the Spanish flu pandemic affect the suffrage movement? And that question comes from Susan Osborne.
Yeah, it's such a good question, and it's suddenly on so many people's minds now that we're living in a pandemic, thus assembled in this way. And to be honest, I don't know. I really don't know. And there's been some writing trying to sort of sort some of these things out, but it's just not a topic I have spent much time paying attention to. So I wish I could answer that more, but certainly it would have restricted organizing and activism in the streets, right? So.
Yeah, absolutely. One of the few things that I do know, because we have been asked questions before, is just that mail-in voting was in fact one of the solutions that people came to, not only just because of the flu pandemic, but also because there was this massive world war occurring, and there were 2 million Americans, and not all of them citizens. But they were fighting for the United States who were overseas. And those citizens, if, as was just brilliantly and very efficiently explained, if they met the parameters to have the right to vote, many of them did send their vote in via mail. As a matter of fact, that is that was very assistive for that movement towards the ratification of the 19th Amendment.
Yeah, we've had voting by mail since the Civil War, and war has often been an occasion for voting by mail. And voting by mail is not, although the incident for fraud is or of error is slightly higher, it is still less than 1%. So when you say sort of it's more dangerous, but by such a small margin that it's not actually, like, there's a huge campaign right now to say that vote by mail is fraudulent. It is going to ruin the election, blah, blah, blah. A lot of people are arguing that's voter suppression because that is not true. And there has never been evidence that vote by mail is as fraudulent as is currently being alleged. So.
Now, we've had, there's another historian who has said that when you have major splintering in organizations, that actually may be the harbinger that cultural and community change is going to come. Someone on our Zoom conversation asked, could you share how these two suffrage organizations that clearly had fractured were able to actually come together and work together to achieve the vote?
Yeah, so the National and the American come together in 1890, but it's not that they finally reach a peaceful resolution. In fact, what's happened is a whole lot of political maneuvering. Stanton and Anthony are trying to take over Lucy Stone's organization. There are a lot of young people in the movement who don't understand the split and think it's hurting the cause. And unification is incredibly divisive within the National, Stanton and Anthony's organization. And it doesn't look like it's going to pass. Most of the people in the National are not supporting it. Anthony holds a late night vote after everybody has left, declares it binding, although it's only like a handful of people who vote for it, and then forces it through. This is a woman who supports voting, right? Forces it through, declares unification. Lucy Stone at this point is quite sick with stomach cancer. She's not able to be there. She's kind of sidelined. And Anthony really kind of triumphantly takes over the American and forms the National American. So this idea that they sort of came together is a bit Stanton and Anthony and Lucy Stone would hate each other for, you know, the rest of their lives. And then, you know, Nassau goes on, and then there's all kinds of fighting inside Nassau, including over who leadership should be. And then Ellis Paul breaks out. And so, you know, social organizing is a lot messier than we would like to think it is.
True. Again, looking back to the past, because we have questions that span 100 plus years here. Any comments about the fact that when a female U.S. citizen married a non-citizen, she lost her citizenship? If her became a citizen, then she became a citizen. This didn't change until after women got the vote.
So one of the ways you could lose voting access if you were a woman and you lived in one of those states that was voting before, 1920, and you met all the other criteria, was that there was a law, and this was part of the concern at the turn of the century about a kind of race suicide, that, you know, brown and, you know, swarthy people and dark people were going to overtake the white race. And so what they started to do was dissuade white women from coupling with men of color. And so if you, or, you know, an immigrant, essentially. So if you married someone who was not a U.S. citizen, but you as a woman were a U.S. citizen, instead of your husband or your spouse getting citizenship, which is what would happen now, the woman lost her U.S. citizenship for having done something as, you know, horrible as, you know, marrying someone who was a foreigner. So yes, you could, and once you lost citizenship, then you would be ineligible to vote. I just want to point out here, somebody wrote in, why didn't Stanton and Anthony foresee the need for a federal right to vote? And that is a fascinating question. And the answer is they did. And it goes back to the 15th Amendment debate, and they were not alone in this, but it goes back to the 15th Amendment debate that we have had people throughout history who have argued what we ought to press for is a federal right to vote. But the United States federal government has consistently pushed back on that and refused to do it. And so one of the strategies that Stanton and Anthony will pursue after the 16th Amendment, or kind of during the launch of the 16th Amendment campaign, is something called the New Departure. And this was a kind of creative read of the Constitution that says, as a citizen, I have a right to vote. And therefore, all I need to do is go vote, test my argument in the courts, get the courts to agree, and then all women will be enfranchised, or at least. So this is famously, a lot of people know that Susan B. Anthony cast a vote famously in 1872. That's part of this New Departure strategy, arguing that all citizens are invested with voting power. This goes all the way up to the United States Supreme Court in Minor v. Happersett. And you know what the Supreme Court says in response? That's wrong. There is no right to vote in the Constitution. The states can absolutely abridge your right to vote. That's perfectly legal. So again and again and again, efforts for a federal right to vote have not gone very well in U.S. history.
What are, and this comes from John Kohler, I hope I'm saying your name correctly, what are ways to ensure now and in the future that we still have federal protection from voter suppression in individual states? Where do we go from here? And thank you for the suppression, voter suppression insight. It's such a huge debate. I will also echo with more sentences, Carol Hamilton's question. So what can we do?
Well, that of course is a question for a democratic process, right? We as a citizenry, now I'm speaking as a kind of citizen of our nation, and I'm a citizen with you. And I think that's part of the democratic process. What do we do? And I think one of the things that I'm hoping to do with the centennial is just make us aware that this fight isn't over, right? It didn't end. It isn't, we've been handed a history to run with right now, and it's up to us how we run with it. And that will be a partisan, and that will be a divisive fight, and I don't doubt any of that, but it's up to us to decide. But I think one of the things we have to do is be aware that this is happening. And I think the idea that we think we have a federal right to vote, or at least many white people think they do, because they're not usually the ones targeted by voter disenfranchisement, although they are being ensnared in it, we assume somehow that if people aren't voting, it must be for legitimate reasons, right? They must have had the right to vote abridged for a legitimate reason, when really there is no right to vote. And what we're in right now, which I think is so counterproductive and have been always throughout American history, including the 15th and the 19th Amendment, a game of whack-a-mole, essentially, right? Where we try to whack down the little restriction that popped up that prevents you from voting, and we whack that down. But then the state pops up five more over here, right? They're just new and creative ways that have not yet been explicitly restricted by the federal government. And then you have to whack down those five, or you get four down, and then 15 more pop up. And that's the state we're in right now. And so the way we do this, I think we can try to strike down those things at the state level if we think they should be struck down, or we can support the erection of them if we think they should be erected, or we can create a federal right to vote, which would just squash all of that, right, in perpetuity, right? But that has been a really hard sell in American history. States like to restrict voting, and the feds have liked to allow them to continue to do that.
Oh, Dr. Tetrault, thank you so very much. We still have some more questions, and though I may officially end our conversation for our Zoom and Facebook, would you be willing to stay around for just a little
bit longer? Absolutely. Yeah, yeah. Love talking about all this. It's all part of the democratic process, right? So, I'll stick around if anyone wants to stick around, and
Outstanding. Again, ladies and gentlemen, please join me in thanking Dr. Tetrault, and I would highly suggest you take a look at her prize-winning book, The Myth of Seneca Falls, Memory and the Women's Suffrage Movement, 1848 to 1898. Do you have another writing or book that might be coming out that people should be looking for as well?
So I'm doing a genealogy of the 19th Amendment right now, not the fight to win it, but the kind of different iterations of the amendment. Because I don't think we have a real queer question about why we don't even know who wrote the 19th Amendment? Like, that's how little we know about the actual text. Yet we don't actually know who wrote it. But if you go to my webpage, you'll see a lot of podcasts and some public history pieces that are linked there that I've written that mirror the talk that I've given today, if you want to find more information about that.
And what is your webpage?
You would have to take my name and go to Carnegie Mellon University or CMU, and up will pop my faculty webpage in the history department. I think Lisa Tetrault, CMU or Carnegie Mellon, and up it'll pop.
Perfect. And we will try to include that there in the Facebook comments and in the Zoom comments as well. Thank you so very much. If you're able to stay on with us, we're going to answer a few more questions that we have. And if you are not, thank you so much for giving an hour of your evening for this incredibly important and so eloquently shared conversation about the ratification of the 19th Amendment and the next 100 years of voter rights and voter rights suppression. Mm-hmm. All right.